is Korea, a land of beauty, splendor, and readiness on the part of military forces stationed here. This memorial was erected by the Korean government to honor American soldiers who died on this site defending the Republic of South Korea, a nation with a history of turmoil, a nation called, ironically, the Land of the Morning Calm. American involvement in South Korea began in 1950 when North Korean troops using Russian-made tanks crossed the 38th parallel. South Korean troops were forced to retreat, and by the fifth day of the war, the city of Seoul fell into North Korean hands. United Nations forces, including the United States, launched a counteroffensive that by November of 1950 pushed the communist forces deep into northern Korea. With China's entry into the war, the tide again turned. The fledgling U.S. Air Force got its first test in combat using jet aircraft. With an 8-to-1 kill ratio, the test was passed. By the spring of 51, battle lines stabilized along the 38th parallel while a ceasefire was negotiated. Finally, on July 27, 1953, an armistice agreement was signed. A ceasefire was in effect. In 3 years, over 33,000 American troops lost their lives. Today, U.S. forces are still stationed in South Korea, still guarding the 38th parallel, still protecting a fragile truce, still waiting for true peace. Korea is located between the Sea of Japan and the Yellow Sea, with a climate closely matching the American Midwest. Korea is our only major ally on the continent of Asia. Since there is still no true peace in Korea, mission and readiness are essential parts of everyday life here. Because here, the threat from enemy forces is very real and very close. Colonel Chuck Link, base commander at Osan Air Base, explains the mission of the Air Force in Korea.
Our mission here is associated primarily with the defense of the Republic of Korea. And it's an important mission because the enemy is not far away. We have a particularly strong ally with a good relationship with our nation. Our leadership is beginning to understand more and more the strategic significance of the presence of our forces here in Korea. Our people understand that too, and they work hard, harder than I've ever seen anybody work in the Air Force.
I'm a pilot with the 36th Tactical Fighters Squadron Flying Fiends, which is a member of the 51st TAC Fighter Wing here at Osan. Our mission is the air superiority mission. We maintain a high state of readiness at all times, but it takes a very concerted effort on not only our part, but also the people who support us. Maintenance has done a superlative job here, as well as the weapons guys, because without their help in launching those jets, we wouldn't be very effective at doing anything at all against the threat.
Preparing to meet that threat is a constant part of our readiness in Korea. One example of that preparation takes place at Kotar, the newest tactical range in Korea. Range Commander, Lieutenant Colonel James Dozier.
The Korean Tactical Range is one of the most challenging air-to-ground ranges in the world. This range is in an extremely rugged mountainous area. We're set up with 35 square miles within the impact area. We have an airspace here of 324 square miles of air maneuver space. Scattered within this, we have our radar threat emitter devices, along with an acquisition radar, which provides location data to our threat emitters and also acts as our backup communication for the entire range complex. This range is equipped with a television ordnance scoring system, which is called TOSS. Through the use of the television cameras and the computer, score the bombs. We can give that data to the air crews by radio and by telephone modem, send it back to the using unit so that when the aircraft and the crews land, they can use the data for debriefing. This range is extremely challenging in finding a right valley, and it duplicates a target complex or a highly defended complex that you would find in northern Korea. And it really puts pressure on a pilot to get down in that, hit his target with accuracy, and then get out. Additionally, with the electronic warfare threat emitters we have here, we put them in a very terse training situation. Not only have to find a target and hit it with a proper ordnance, but also be able to learn how to survive in a highly defended complex.
Penetrating simulated enemy defenses is an integral part of aircrew training at COTAR. Master Sergeant Bill Smith.
As a threat maintenance supervisor, me and my people are responsible to provide an electronic warfare training environment to ROCAF, USAF, and Navy or Marine air crews as they try to penetrate to the COTAR range complex itself. And we simulate AAA guns, surface-to-air missile systems, trying to intercept the aircraft. And we try to shoot them down before they get into the target area.
So one of the things that benefits out of this range is that air crews can come here and train to operate in any part of the world, not just necessarily Korea.
Missions such as that at COTAR are essential elements of readiness in Korea. So too is the welfare of all members of the Air Force stationed here. Since Korea has been primarily a remote assignment, most people have come unaccompanied. Now, however, some bases authorize command sponsorship for dependents.
Here at Osan, we're concentrating on things that support the family, such as this housing, which we call Mustang Valley. Also in the last 2 years, we've built a brand new commissary, possibly the largest in this part of the world. We've added on to the BX, and we just finished a brand new elementary school, which will be open this fall. There are many more examples of things that are being done here at Osan to make life more pleasant and rewarding for our Air Force people here in Korea.
Before coming to Korea, I was told that the people of Korea were very, very friendly and they liked the Americans a whole lot. And I found this to be very true. The culture in Korea is one of many contrasts. You see the very old and you see the very new, a very beautiful blending.
While the day-to-day welfare of our people concerns us, so too does their safety in the face of the threat. Captain Suzanne Hazenfield.
There's another very important program that we administer out of the personnel division, and it provides for the evacuation of non-combatants or dependents here in Korea. All dependents, as well as the military members, are briefed upon arrival in Korea, and then once every 6 months thereafter on this evacuation plan in an effort to make sure that they are prepared. So we feel it's very important that we're preparing dependents for evacuation as well as providing the necessary military members that we need to support the mission in Korea. So people-wise, we're ready.
During my 8 months here in Korea, I really enjoyed the tour, seeing the country and meeting the people. If I had the opportunity to come back again, I would.
It's one of the better remote tours, I think, in the Air Force.
I really enjoyed my stay here in Korea, and if I ever get the opportunity to do it again, I'll definitely be back.
The main mission of the United States Air Force here in Korea is to protect our resources that we do have here and the interest that we have in this country. It is one of the only major strongholds that we do hold in the continent of Asia, and our main purpose here is for defense of the people here and of our own interest in our own personnel and people back home.
An assignment to Korea is no picnic. It is, however, a demanding, challenging opportunity. An opportunity to participate in the Air Force in an area where we face a very real threat and where the need for readiness is unquestioned. It's a challenge professionally, but it's also an opportunity to see firsthand another culture with a long, rich, and proud heritage. You and Korea, vital parts of the Air Force, now.